Problem 27. If a wet sheet in a dryer loses its moisture at a rate proportional to its moisture content, and if it loses half of its moisture during the first 10 minutes of drying, when will it be practically dry? Say, when will it have lost 99% of its moisture? Let us assume M of T as moisture content in wet sheet at time T. Then we can write minus dm by dt as the rate in which the wet sheet loses its moisture. The negative symbol is here because the wet sheet is losing its moisture. As per the question, this is proportional to m or the moisture content in the wet sheet. From this we can write dm by dt equal to minus k m, where k is a constant of proportionality. This implies dm by m equal to minus k dt. We integrate both sides and this results natural log of m equal to minus k t plus c1, or m as a function of t, or m equal to c e to the power minus k t. This is the general solution of this differential equation, and this gives moisture content in the wet sheet as a function of time t. Now in the general solution, if we substitute t equal to 0, then we get m of 0 equal to c e to the power 0, which implies c equal to m of 0, or we can write this as m subscript 0. That means the value of c is equal to the initial moisture content in the wet sheet. So we can write this equation again as m of t equal to m0 e to the power minus kt, where m0 is the initial moisture content in the wet sheet. M0 is initial moisture content in wet sheet. Now in the question it is given that at t equal to 10 minutes, the moisture content in the wet sheet is half of its initial moisture content, that is m of 10 minute equal to m0 divided by 2, that is half of its initial moisture content. We can substitute this initial value condition and we get m0 by 2 equal to m0 e to the power minus k multiplied by 10. The unit of time is in minutes here. From this we cancel m0 both sides and we can write 0.5 equal to e to the power minus k multiplied by 10, which implies minus k multiplied by 10 equal to natural log of 0.5, which implies k equal to minus natural log of 0.5 divided by 10. This implies k equal to 0.0693. The unit will be minute inverse, because the unit of time here we had taken as minutes, so the unit of k will be in minutes inverse. The question is asking, when will the wet sheet be practically dry? Say, when will it have lost 99% of its moisture? So now we can write this equation as moisture content as a function of time equal to m naught e to the power minus 0.0693 of t. The question is asking, when will the wet sheet lose 99% of its moisture? If the wet sheet loses 99% of its moisture, then the remaining moisture will be 1% of initial moisture or that is 0.01 of m naught. So the question is asking, at what value of time the remaining moisture will be 0.01 m naught. So we can substitute this into this equation, 0.01 m naught equal to m naught e to the power minus 0.0693 of t. This implies e to the power minus 0.0693 t equal to 0.01, which implies t equal to minus natural log of 0.01 divided by 0.0693. So t equal to 66.45, and the unit will be in minutes because the unit of k was in minute inverse. So the wet sheet will take 66.45 minutes to lose 99% of its moisture. Problem 28. Could you see practically without calculation that the answer in problem 27 must lie between 60 and 70 minutes? In problem 27, we have already obtained the answer. The answer was 66.45 minutes. That is, the wet sheet loses 99% of its moisture in 66.45 minutes. Now in problem 28, the question is asking to estimate that the answer lies between 60 and 70 minutes. As per the question, at time t equal to 0, the moisture content mt in the wet sheet was 100% and the moisture lost from the wet sheet is 0%. It is also given in the question that after 10 minutes, the wet sheet loses half of its moisture, so the remaining moisture is 50% because the moisture lost is 50%. Now in the question it is given that the wet sheet loses moisture at a rate proportional to its moisture content or m of t. This m of t is the moisture content. So initially the moisture content was 100% and it lost 50% of its moisture in 10 minutes. Now the moisture content is 50% after 10 minutes. So again, after 10 minutes more, that is after 20 minutes, it will lose again half of its moisture. That is 25% more moisture will be lost, or half of the given moisture content, and the remaining moisture content will be 25%. The moisture loss will be 50% plus 25%, that is 75%. Again after 10 minutes, that is at 30 minutes, half of the moisture content at 20 minutes will be lost. So the remaining moisture content will be 12.5% and this will be 75 plus 12.5%, which is equal to 87.5%. 87.5% of moisture is lost after 30 minutes. Similarly, after 40 minutes, this will again reduce to half, and this will be 6.25%, and the moisture lost will be 87.5% plus 6.25%, which is 93.75%. Again, after 10 minutes, that is after 50 minutes, this will again reduce to half, which will be 3.125%, and this will be 93.75 plus 3.125, which is 96.875%. And after 60 minutes, this will again reduce to half, which will be 1.5625%, and the moisture lost will be 98.4375%. And after 70 minutes, this will again reduce to half, which will be 0.78125%, and this will be 99.22% approximately. So we see that at 60 minutes, 99% of moisture is still not lost, as it is less than 98, and after 70 minutes, higher than 99% of moisture is lost. So the answer will be in between this. We've got the answer 66.45 minutes in the previous problem, which lies between 60 and 70 minutes. Problem 29. Jack, arrested when leaving a bar, claims that he has been inside for at least half an hour, which would provide him with an alibi. The police check the water temperature of his car parked near the entrance of the bar at the instant of the arrest and again 30 minutes later, obtaining the values 190 degrees Fahrenheit and 110 degrees Fahrenheit respectively. Do the results give Jack an alibi? Solve by inspection. The question is asking us to solve the problem by inspection, so we are not going to formulate a mathematical model, but instead we are going to inspect Jack's timeline. Let us first list the events and when it happened. Events and time of happening the event. Let us take the event of arrest at t equal to 0. At t equal to 0, the temperature of water in Jack's car is 190 degrees Fahrenheit. And let us take the temperature of surrounding as Ts, which is a constant. As per the question, 30 minutes after arrest, the time will be 30 minutes and the temperature of water is 110 degrees Fahrenheit. And let us assume that the temperature of surrounding is the same, which is Ts. Now Jack is claiming that he has been inside the bar for at least half an hour. So let us take another event, which was 30 minutes before the arrest. At this time will be minus 30 minutes. We don't know the temperature of water at that time, so let us take it as X. And let us assume that the temperature of surrounding remains constant in all the three events. The question is asking, do the results give Jack an alibi? We know from Newton's law of cooling that rate of change of temperature with respect to time is proportional to temperature of the body minus temperature of surrounding. Let us calculate temperature of water minus temperature of surrounding in all three cases. In first case, it will be X minus Ts. In the second case, it will be 190 minus Ts. And in the third case, it will be 110 minus ts. Now let us assign the first one equal to p, the second one equal to q, and the third one equal to r. We can clearly see that p is greater than q, which is greater than r, because the second term ts is constant and the first term is highest in the first case, little bit lower in the second case, and a little bit lower in the third case, because the water inside the car is losing heat to the surrounding and the temperature is gradually decreasing. In the second and third case, we can clearly see that the temperature is decreased to 110 degree Fahrenheit from 190 degree Fahrenheit. So in the first case, the temperature must be greater than 190 degrees Fahrenheit. That is, x must be greater than 190 degrees Fahrenheit. So we can conclude that P is greater than Q, which is greater than R. From Newton's law of cooling, we can say that the rate at which the water is losing the heat, that is delta capital T by delta small t, must be highest in the first case and lowest in the third case. Let us assume this interval as interval A and this interval as interval B. Now we can clearly see that delta T by delta small t for case A is greater than delta T by delta T in interval B, because in interval A the temperature of water is higher than in the interval B. So the rate of change of temperature is also higher in the interval A than the interval B. Now we can see that delta T in interval A is equal to delta T in interval B, which is 30 minutes as we have taken. This interval delta T is 30 minutes. Also in this case, delta T of B is 30 minutes. So from this we conclude that delta capital T, or change in temperature in interval A, must be greater than change in temperature in interval B. We know that the change in temperature in interval B is 80 degrees Fahrenheit. So that means change in temperature in interval A must be greater than 80 degrees Fahrenheit. So this change in temperature must be greater than 80 degrees Fahrenheit. From this, we can calculate the minimum value of x. If it is 190 degrees Celsius, then the minimum value of x will be 190 degrees Fahrenheit plus 80, which is equal to 270 degrees Fahrenheit. So from this we conclude that x must be greater than 270 degrees Fahrenheit. That is, 30 minutes before the arrest, the temperature of water must be greater than 270 degrees Fahrenheit. But we know that the boiling point of water equal to 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Above 212 degrees Fahrenheit, the water will convert into steam. So the temperature of water cannot be 270 degrees Fahrenheit. This implies Jack was not inside the bar 30 minutes before. If Jack were inside the bar 30 minutes before, then the temperature of water must be 270 degrees Fahrenheit when he stopped the car, which is impossible. So Jack is lying. That means he doesn't have an alibi. Problem 30. A rocket is shot straight up from the earth with a net acceleration of 70 meter per second square during the initial stage of flight until the engine cut out at t equal to 10 seconds. How high will it go? A resistance neglected. This diagram shows the vertical motion of the rocket. Let us choose three points, A, B, and C, in the path of the rocket. Now let us understand the motion of the rocket. The rocket starts moving at position A, which is ground level, and moves to position B. During its motion from A to B, the rocket is being accelerated at 70 meter per second square. From position B to position C, the engine is cut out, so there is no thrust on the rocket, and the rocket is moving upwards because of inertia. At position C, the velocity of the rocket becomes zero and the rocket reaches its maximum height. The question is asking, how high will it go? That is, the question is asking the distance from position A to position C.
at A the time t equal to 0 because the rocket starts moving at A. As per the question, at B time t equal to 10 seconds, the rocket is being accelerated from A to B at an acceleration of 70 meter per second square, and the engine is cut off at t equal to 10 seconds. So we take time t is 10 seconds at B, and at C let us take the time is tm or t maximum. Similarly, the velocity here, that is v naught equal to 0, that is the initial velocity was 0. Let us take here the velocity was vb and here the velocity was vc. Now we know from position A to B the acceleration was 70 meter per second square. From its motion from A to B, there are two forces acting on the rocket. Force 1 is due to, now from position A to B there are two forces acting on the rocket. The first force is upwards, which is force due to the rocket engine or the thrust of the rocket engine, and there is a downward force which is the force of gravity, and as per Newton's law, Fr minus Fg will be equal to ma, and in the question it is given that the net acceleration or acceleration by the rocket minus gravitational pullback is 70 meter per second square, that is Fr minus Fg is equal to ma as per Newton's second law, and this acceleration that we get from this equation, that is Fr minus Fg by m, is 70 meter per second square, which is the net acceleration. From position B to C, there is no thrust on the rocket because the engine has been cut out. So there is only one downward force, which is mg or gravitational pull, which is equal to ma as per Newton's second law. So the acceleration equal to g or gravitational acceleration, but since the rocket is decelerating in this phase, so the rate of change of velocity or acceleration will be negative. So that is why we take acceleration equal to minus g. For motion from A to B, the acceleration equal to dv by dt or the rate of change of velocity, which is equal to 70 meter per second square as given in the question. From here we can write dv equal to 70 dt, we integrate both sides and we get velocity v equal to 7 t square by 2 plus a constant c1. Now from the initial condition we have got that at time t equal to 0 the velocity was 0, which we can substitute in this equation, and we get velocity equal to 0 at time t equal to 0, which is 0 square plus c1, and this implies c1 equal to 0, and our equation of velocity reduces to v equal to 7 by 2 t square. This is the equation of velocity of the rocket for its motion from A to B. Now we can write velocity as derivative of displacement with respect to time, so which is dx by dt equal to 7 by 2 t square, which implies dx equal to 7 by 2 t square dt. We integrate both sides and we get x or displacement equal to 7 by 6 t cube plus a constant c2. Now in the path of the rocket, we can take the bottom position as x equal to 0, that is the origin of our one dimensional coordinate system. So the bottom position we can take x equal to 0, and we can take the upward direction as positive x direction. So we get the initial condition x equal to 0 at time t equal to 0. We can take the distance till B as xB and the distance at C as xC. So the total distance from A to C is xC and total distance from A to B is xB. We can set the initial condition x equal to 0 at time t equal to 0 in this equation, and we get 0 equal to 0 plus C2, which implies C2 equal to 0, and our equation of distance or displacement becomes x equal to 7 by 6 tq for its motion from A to B. Now we have two equations, the velocity as a function of time, let us take it as equation 1, and the distance as a function of time, let us take it as a equation 2. These two equations are only valid for the motion of the rocket from position A to position B. At position B, the time is 10 seconds, so we can calculate velocity at position B, that is VB, by substituting t equal to 10 in the equation 1. So this will be 7 by 2 multiplied by 10 square, which implies velocity at position B equal to 350 meters. We can calculate the distance of position B from position A, that is xB, which is equal to 7 by 6 multiplied by 10 cube, which is 7000 by 6 meters. Sorry, the velocity will be 350 meters per second. So at position B, we can write VB equal to 350 meters per second and XB equal to 7000 by 6 meters. That is, the distance from A to B is 7000 by 6 meters, or approximately a little bit more than 1 kilometer. Now we will analyze the motion of the rocket from position B to position C. From B to C, the net acceleration on the rocket is minus g, so we can write A equal to dv by dt, which is equal to minus g, because the rocket is decelerating, so we have taken the acceleration as minus g. Again, the reason for this negative sign is the left hand side gives the rate of increase of velocity with respect to time, however the velocity actually is decreasing with respect to time, that is why we have taken this negative symbol. Now this implies dv equal to minus g dt, which implies v equal to minus gt plus a constant c3. One important thing to note here is that this equation is the velocity of the rocket only for its motion from B to C, and it is not valid for its motion from A to B. To get the value of C3, we will substitute initial Van-Loo condition, that is the velocity at position B at time t equal to 10 seconds. So we have VB equal to 350 meters per second at time t equal to 10 seconds, which we can substitute in this equation, and we get 350 equal to minus 98 plus C3. We have taken G as 9.8 meter per second square. So from here we can write C3 equal to 448. Now the equation of velocity becomes V equal to minus 9.8 T plus C3, which is 448. This equation gives velocity of the rocket at time t from position B to position C. Now we can write velocity equal to dx by dt, or rate of change of displacement with respect to time, which implies dx by dt equal to minus 9.8 t plus 448. And this implies dx equal to minus 9.8 t plus 448 multiplied by dt, and we integrate both sides, and from here we can get x equal to minus 9.8 t square by 2 plus 448 t plus c4, which is a constant of integration. Now at position b, we know that xb equal to 7000 by 6 meters at time t equal to 10 seconds, which we can substitute in this equation to get the value of c4. So here we can write 7000 by 6 equal to minus 9.8 by 2 t square, which is 100, plus 448 t, which is 4480, plus c4, and this implies c4 equal to 7000 by 6 plus 980 divided by 2 minus 4480, which implies c4 equal to minus 2823.34. So we can write the equation of distance with respect to time as minus 9.8 by 2 t square plus 448 t minus 2823.34. Now this equation gives the distance at any time t for its movement from B to C. Now we know that the engine has been cut out at position B, so there is no net upwards force on the rocket for its motion from B to C, and the rocket is moving upwards due to inertia only. So if C is the maximum height that the rocket reaches, then the velocity at C will be 0, that is VC will be 0, and after that, due to gravitational pullback, it starts moving from C downwards towards the earth. So at position C, we have velocity VC equal to 0. We can put this in this equation, that is velocity VC equal to 0 at t equal to tm, and we can calculate the time t at position C. So we can write velocity V at C equal to 0 at time t equal to tm or t equal to tc, that is at position C the velocity is 0. We can substitute this in this equation and we can write, now we have the equation V equal to minus 9.8 t plus 448. From here this equation gives the velocity of the rocket as a function of time t for its motion from B to C. In this equation we can put V equal to 0 and t equal to tm or tc, and we get 0 equal to minus 9.8 tm plus 448, which implies tm equal to 448 divided by 9.8 or 45.71 seconds. So now we have the time t at C, which is equal to 45.71 seconds. Now only we have to find the xc, that is the distance of position C from position A. We can get this by substituting t equal to 45.71 seconds in this equation. So we can write xc, or distance from point A, that is from the ground to point C, equal to माइनस 9.8 बाई 2 मल्टीप्लाइड बाय 45.71 स्क्वायर प्लस 448 मल्टीप्लाइड बाय 45.71 माइनस 2823.34 विच इज इक्वल टू द फर्स्ट टर्म बिकम्स माइनस 10238.08 द सेकेंड टर्म बिकम्स 20478.08 सो द आंसर इज 7416.66 मीटर्स विच इज इक्वल टू 7.41 किलोमीटर्स. Now the question is asking how high will the rocket go by neglecting air resistance. The total distance traveled by the rocket is from position A to position C. This total distance is xc, which we have calculated here as 7.41 kilometers. So the total distance traveled by the rocket is 7.41 kilometers, which is the answer. Problem 31. Solution curves of y dash equal to g of y by x. Show that any non-vertical straight line through the origin of the xy plane intersects all these curves of a given ODE at the same angle. The differential equation given is y dash equal to g of y by x. Its solution will be of the form y equal to f of x. That is the explicit form of the solution. So this ODE gives the slope of y equal to f of x at any point x comma y. Now in the question it is given that the straight lines which are intersecting with these solution curves are passing through the origin. Y equal to mx plus c is the general equation of a straight line. Now since the straight lines are passing through the origin, that is 0 comma 0, we can put this in this general form to get 0 equal to m multiplied by 0 plus c, which implies c equal to 0. We can substitute this in here to get the general equation of a straight line passing through the origin, which is y equal to mx. Now in the question it is given that the straight lines which are intersecting with the curve are non-vertical, because for vertical straight lines m tends to infinity. So to exclude these straight lines where m tends to infinity, the question is saying that the straight lines are non-vertical. Now let us draw the two-dimensional xy plane. This is the xy plane with x in the horizontal axis and y as the vertical axis. Now let us draw a few of the solution curves of the given ODE. Suppose these are two of the many solution curves of the given ODE of the form y equal to f of x. Now let us draw the straight line passing through the origin. This straight line intersects the curves at two points, point A and point B. Now let us assume that the coordinates of point A equal to x1 comma y1 and the coordinates of point B are x2 comma y2. Now from basic calculus we know that if two curves like such f of x and g of x are intersecting at a point x0 comma y zero, then the angle of intersection is same as the angle between the tangents of the two curves at those points. That is, at x zero comma y zero, if this is the tangent of g of x, and if this is the tangent of f of x, then the angle of intersection alpha is same as the angle of intersection of the two tangents. Now, if m1 is the slope of the tangent of the curve f of x, then m1 will be equal to derivative of f of x with respect to x at point x0 comma y0, and the slope of tangent of g of x will be m2, that is d of g of x by dx at point x0 comma y0. This m1 and m2 are the slope of the tangents of the curves f of x and g of x at point x0 comma y0. Then tan of alpha, where alpha is the angle of intersection of the curves or the angle between the tangents, will be equal to m1 minus m2 divided by 1 plus m1 m2. Here alpha is the acute angle between the tangents curves or tangents. Now we can use this formula to find out the angle of intersection of the straight line with the solution curves of DODE y dash equal to g of y by x. Now at point A, we can see that the slope of the straight line is m, because the slope of the straight line is same at all points of the line, and the slope of the solution curve y equal to f of x will be given by the ODE y dash equal to g of y by x. This is the slope, and this slope is given by this equation. Now, as the straight line is intersecting the curve, so we can put y equal to mx in here, because the straight line is intersecting the curve, and for the straight line y equal to mx. So from here we can get g of mx by x, x and x cancels, so this is equal to g of m. Now the angle of intersection between the straight line and the slope can be calculated by using this formula, alpha equal to tan inverse m, that is the slope of the first curve or the slope of the straight line, minus gm divided by 1 plus m multiplied by gm. This is for point A. Similarly, at point B, the slope of the straight line is still m. Slope of the curve y equal to f of x is same as y dash equal to g of m, because the slope, as we can see from here, is not dependent on x or y values. Slope is dependent on m values, where m is a constant, or m is the slope of the straight line. So this is actually a constant, because the slope is dependent on m values, and m is same for point A and point B. So for the curve, the slope is same in point B also, so alpha will be same, that is tan inverse m, which is the slope of the straight line at point B, multiplied by g of m, that is slope of the tangent to the solution curve at point B, divided by 1 plus m multiplied by g of m. We see that at point A and at point B, the angle of intersection is the same. The basic reason is that the slope of the straight line is constant, also the slope of the solution curve y equal to f of x is same, which is g of m, and is independent of x and y. Now, because the slope of both the solution curve and the straight line at the point of intersection are same for all points, that is why the angle of intersection are same. That means if this is the tangent to the solution curve at point A and this is the tangent to the solution curve at point B, then this angle alpha 1 and this angle alpha 2 are same for ODEs of the form y dash equal to g of y by x. Problem 32. Friction. If a body slides on a surface, it experiences friction F, a force against the direction of motion. Experiments show that F equal to mu n, where n is the normal force, the force that holds the two surfaces together, and the constant of proportionality mu is called the coefficient of kinetic friction. In figure, assume that the body weighs 45 newtons, about 10 pounds. Mu is given as 0.2. The angle alpha is given as 30 degrees. The slide is 10 meters long and the initial velocity is 0. And the air resistance is negligible. Find the velocity of the body at the end of the slide. Now let us take 3 points on the slide, point A, point B, and the end point C. In the question, it is given that velocity at A or initial velocity was 0. At this position, time was also 0. And the distance covered or S of t is 0. For position B, we can see that the distance covered is S of t. And for position C, the distance covered S of t is the total length of the slide, which is given 10 meters. Now let us assume that the x direction is parallel to the surface of the slide and the y direction as perpendicular to the surface of the slide. Now we can see that if this angle is alpha and this angle is 90 degrees, then this angle will be 90 minus alpha, because the sum of three angles of a triangle is 180 degrees. So this angle will be alpha, because this whole angle is 90 degrees and this angle is 90 minus alpha. So this remaining angle will be alpha. We can resolve the weight vector into two vectors, parallel to the surface of the slide and perpendicular to the surface of the slide. For this weight vector, if this angle is alpha, then this component of weight vector will be w cos alpha, and the component that is parallel to the x-axis will be w sin alpha. We have resolved this weight vector into two components, one component being parallel to the x-axis or the surface of the slide, and the other component perpendicular to the x-axis. Now we can draw the free body diagram. Suppose this is the body. From here we can see that in x-axis, towards the right hand side, a component of weight w sin alpha is there. So from here we can draw w sin alpha in the right direction. Now it is given in the question that the friction force is the force against the direction of motion. Now the body is sliding downwards the slope, so the force of friction will be opposite to the direction of motion. This is the frictional force F. So the friction force will be opposite to the direction of motion F, which is equal to, as given in the question, mu n. Now let us write the components in the y axis. We can see that the weight component acting downwards is W cos alpha. So this is W cos alpha, and the normal force will be perpendicular to the body upwards. Now in this free body diagram, we are showing the forces that are acting on the body. In the question, it is shown that the normal force is downwards. However, the normal force is actually acting upwards because the body is pushing the surface downwards because of its weight, and the surface has an equal and opposite reaction which is forcing the body upwards. So the force of the surface on the body is upwards, and in the free body diagram we are writing only those forces which are acting on the body. So the normal force will be upwards. Now we see that in the x axis the body is accelerating downwards because the forces are not balanced. However, there is no motion in the y axis. So for the y axis the forces are balanced. However, for the x axis the forces are not balanced. So we can write from Newton's second law of motion, for the x axis W sin alpha minus F equal to ma, because the body is accelerating and the forces are not balanced. So the net force equal to ma. However, in the y axis the forces are balanced, so we can write N equal to W cos alpha. Now in the question, the following data has been given, that alpha equal to 30 degrees. Also the weight of the body W has been given, which is 45 newtons. Now since the unit is in newtons, so this is the weight and not the mass of the body. Now weight we know as mg, so mg equal to 45 newtons. Let us assume this as equation 1 and this as equation 2, and from equation 1 we can write W sin alpha is sin 30 degrees, which is half, minus F is mu n, and mu is given 0.2, so we can write this as 0.2 n equal to mass times acceleration. Now from equation 2 we can write that n equal to W cos alpha, and alpha is 30 degrees, so cos alpha will be root 3 by 2. This n we can plug in here to get W multiplied by half minus 0.2 W root 3 by 2 equal to ma, and this implies W whole into half minus 0.2, we can write as 1 by 5, so this will be 1 by 5 multiplied by root 3 by 2 equal to ma. This W we can write as mg, and the m cancels from the right and left hand side, and we get the acceleration as g multiplied by 1 by 2 minus root 3 by 10, which is equal to g multiplied by, we take 10 in the denominator and write 5 minus root 3 in the numerator. Now this is the acceleration of the body in the x axis in the this direction. We can write acceleration as dv by dt, and we can write this equation as dv by dt equal to this whole thing here, which implies dv equal to g whole into 5 minus root 3 by 10 dt. We integrate both sides and we get v equal to g whole into 5 minus root 3 by 10 t plus constant of proportionality c1. Now we can see from the initial value condition that at time t equal to 0, the velocity was 0, which means the initial velocity was 0. We can substitute that in this equation to get the value of c1. We write velocity was 0 at time. Now the question is asking to find the velocity at the end of the slide. So to find the velocity at the end of the slide, we have to know the time at the end of the slide. However, we have not been given any data regarding the velocity at any point in the slide, but we have been given the length of the slide. So if we find s or distance as a function of t, then we can find the corresponding time at the end of the slide, and then we can find the velocity. So from here we can write derivative of s of t by dt, which is same as the velocity as a function of time t. S is the distance from point A as a function of time t, and this is g 5 minus root 3 by 10 multiplied by t, which implies ds equal to g whole into 5 minus root 3 by 10 t dt. We integrate both sides, and from here we can obtain s as a function of time t, or s equal to g 5 minus root 3 by 10 t square by 2 plus a constant c2. We can see at point A the distance covered was 0 at time t equal to 0. So from here we can write the distance 0 equal to g whole into 5 minus root 3 by 10 multiplied by time t is 0, 0 square by 2 plus c2, which implies c2 equal to 0. And this distance as a function of time t equation we can write as s of t equal to g whole into 5 minus root 3 by 20 multiplied by t square plus c2 constant is 0. Now let us take this equation as equation 3 and this as equation 4. Now the equation 3 gives the velocity of the body as a function of time t as the body slides on the surface in the x-axis, and equation 4 gives the distance covered by the body as a function of time t. Now in the question it is given that the total length of the slide is 10 meters. So from equation 4 we can plug in 10 meters in here to get the time taken to reach the end of the slide, and this time we can plug in here to find the velocity at the end of the slide. So we'll write 10 equal to g 5 minus root 3 by 20 t square, which implies t square equal to 200 divided by g whole into 5 minus root 3, which implies t square equal to 6.2449, which implies t equal to square root of 6.2449, which is 2.4989. seconds. So the body takes 2.4989 seconds to reach the end of the slide. Now we can find the velocity at the end of the slide by plugging this value of time t in equation 3. So the velocity will be v equal to g multiplied by 5 minus root 3 by 10 multiplied by the time at the end of the slide, or time at position C, which is 2.4989, and this is equal to 8 meters per second. So the velocity at the end of the slide or at position C in the diagram is 8 meters per second, which is the answer. Problem 33. To tie a boat in a harbor, how many times must a rope be wound around a bollard so that a man holding one end of the rope can resist a force exerted by the boat 1000 times greater than the man can exert? Experiments show that the change delta S of the force S in a small portion of the rope is proportional to S and to the small angle delta phi in figure 16. Take the proportionality constant 0.15, the result should surprise you. Now this is a bollard, it is a cylindrical post fixed to the ground. A rope is wound around the bollard and one end of the rope is tied to a boat and the other end is held by a man. And the question is saying that the force exerted by the boat is 1000 times greater than the man can exert. Now as per the question, the change in force delta S is proportional to the force S and to the small angle delta phi. So we can write change in force delta S is proportional to S multiplied by delta phi. This we can write as delta S equal to K S delta phi by introducing a constant of proportionality K. In the question it is given that the constant of proportionality K is equal to 0.15, so we can write this equation as delta S equal to 0.15 S delta phi. Now in the diagram you can see that this internal angle is delta phi. For this much change in angle we can see that the force changes from S to S plus delta S, that is there is a change of delta S in force due to change of delta phi in angle. Now if we set delta phi tends to 0, that is if we take a very small slice of the circle, then we can write ds equal to 0.15 s d phi. Because the change in angle is very small, so the change in force is also very small, so we write the change in force as ds and the change in angle as d phi for phi tends to 0. Now this is the differential equation. We can separate the variables by writing ds by s equal to 0.15 d phi. We have separated the variables s and phi, we integrate both sides and we can write this as natural log of s equal to 0.15 phi plus a constant of proportionality c1. This we can write as s equal to c e to the power 0.15 phi. Now if we take phi equal to 0, that is if we take this angle equal to 0, then there will be no change in force. That means suppose this is the top view of the bollard and the rope just comes in and goes out, doesn't turn around the bollard, then in this case the angle will be 0 because the rope has not been tied around the bollard. So in this case the force in this side will be same as the force in this side because the rope has not been tied around the bollard at all. So for phi equal to 0, let us take S equal to S0 or force exerted at angle 0. We can write this equation as S0 equal to C e to the power 0.15 multiplied by phi, which is 0, and this implies C equal to S0 or force for angle 0. So this equation can be written as S equal to S0 e to the power 0.15 phi. Now consider this diagram. The question is saying that the force exerted by the boat is 1000 times greater than the man can exert. So if the man exerts force of S0, then the boat exerts force of 1000 times S0. Now assume that this end is being pulled by the man and the rope is wound around the bollard, and the other end after a few turns is pulled by the boat, then this S we can write as 1000 of S0 equal to S0 e to the power 0.155. This can be written as 1000 equal to e to the power 0.155. We take natural log on both sides and we write phi equal to natural log of 1000 divided by 0.15, which is equal to 46.05. Now in the diagram you can see that for one total revolution the angle phi will be 2 pi. So for n revolutions the angle phi will be 2 pi n. So we can write this phi as 2 pi n to calculate the number of times the rope has been wound around the bollard. This 2 pi n is equal to 46.05. That implies the number of times the rope has been wound around the bollard is 46.05 divided by 2 pi, which is equal to 7.32. That is, the wire has to be wound around the bollard 7 complete times and 0.32 of 2 pi angles for the man to withstand the force exerted by the boat. We can also round off this number n and write n equal to 8 to make it an integer, and we can say that the rope has to be tied 8 times around the bollard for the man to withstand the force exerted by the boat.